To everyone who's lost someone they love, long before it was their time. You feel like the days you had were not enough when you said goodbye. And to all other people with burdens and pains, keeping you back from your life. You believe that there's nothing and there is no one who can make it right. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, and love for the broken heart. And there is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He'll meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. Cry out to Jesus. Struggling just to hang on, they've lost all of their faith and love, and they've done all they can to make it right again. Still, it's not enough. And for the ones who can't break the addictions and chains, you try to give up, but you can't. Tears from her eyes, and for the children around the world without a home, say a prayer tonight. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, and love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He'll meet you.
Thank you for coming today. Just a little bit of information I want to give you guys before we really get started. This Friday will be the burial up at Fort Custer National Cemetery in Augusta. There are maps available here if you need that in order to get there. For Jeff, the burial will be at 10 o'clock. And for David Howell, it will be at 11:30. But it's recommended that you get there at least 15 minutes early or you may not be allowed in. So just be aware of that. That is this Friday, and that's not printed in anything, so just so you're aware of that. This Friday, 10 and 11:30. Let's pray together, and then I'll read through part of the obituary. So, Father, just thank you for the time to remember Jeff, for the time for family and friends to gather and to comfort each other, and to remember and to smile and to cry and to do that with each other. And so, Father, I just ask for your help, for your blessing on the time of memories being shared now and in the days ahead, and that, Father, that you will just remind everyone here how much you do care, how much you care, and how you are you're watching, and that you are here. You know what's going on, and you comfort those who mourn, and that you are good. And so, Father, guide our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Jeff was born on June 16th, 1971, in Kalamazoo, Michigan, to the late Barry and Carol Yeomans. After his father passed away, Jeff was 6 years old when adopted by his aunt and uncle, John and Shirley Breedveld. During his teenage years, he went to live with his stepmom, Kay, who later adopted him. Jeff is a 1990 graduate of Brandywine High School. He served his country proudly, receiving an honorable discharge from the U.S. Air Force. He has worked as a cook for many years at the tavern in Niles, enjoyed fishing, watching movies, and football. To say that he was a Michigan fan was an understatement. I assume that you all realize that, given the amount of Michigan gear that is all around. I am in foreign country right now. We'll work through it together. It's all right. As a Michigan fan, I wonder what Jeff thought of some of the recent announcements about coming out of the University of Michigan about how many or how few fans will be allowed at sporting events this year. I know I have a friend who is supposed to take their son for the first time, and they were going to become one of those radical Michigan fans. You know, the kind that you want if you're a Michigan fan. And they're pretty sure they're going to get cut. And I just looked at that as an opportunity for Notre Dame, but, you know, the opportunity for something. So he also looked forward to spending time with family, including trips to Pizza Hut with nieces and nephews. And I have heard that he loved just opportunities to talk to people. And he would make the most of those times. He is preceded in death by his parents and step-parents, and there is a long list of surviving family that is mentioned there as well. A couple of those family members have asked for a chance to share some memories, and so Stephanie and Jason are going to come up.
Okay. Let me get this all situated here. Okay. Jeffrey, Jeffro, and Bro were all names used to address our brother. With these names come memories we all shared with him. So Jason and I would like to share some of our memories of Jeff with you. We'll start with a funny one. Okay. One year, while camping with Mike and Kay Ryder during Memorial Day weekend, we wanted to have a bonfire and needed to collect some kindling. So each of us went to gather our kindling, and while most of us came back with twigs, Jeff came back with a load of road apples. You guessed it, manure. He thought those dried road apples would start a great fire, but instead it just made for great laughter. Another time on the 4th of July, we went to the fireworks display in Kalamazoo with the neighbors. There were a lot of large pipes stacked up on top of each other, which made for a great climbing apparatus. While at the top, Jeff decided to do a Superman leap and fell and broke both arms. He was in casts past his elbows and, as you can imagine, unable to eat, shower, and care for himself. Although this might not seem funny, trying to feed an adolescent can be very comical at times. It seems like climbing high obstacles was a pretty familiar scenario for us, because at Grandma and Grandpa Vandermolen's, we would go beyond the backyard of their house and climb this large dirt hill and play King of the Mountain. Another time at our Grandma and Grandpa Yeomans' summer home, the old schoolhouse in Kalkaska, Michigan, there was an old mattress that hung from the ceiling of the basement that we used as a makeshift swing. We would get on that mattress, and our cousins Doug and Bill Wilbur would swing us so high we could feel our bodies lift up off that mattress, and we would bounce around. We would be so giggly and silly for hours on that swing. One time, the three of us kids decided to walk on the train tracks to our Aunt Sherry's beauty shop in Bellevue. When we started to feel the train rails vibrate, we would tape pennies to the train rail, get out of the way, and then when the train had passed, go and collect our flattened treasure. This was a 3-mile trek for us kids, so you can imagine once we got to the beauty shop, we were in so much trouble from that adventure.
The train tracks, they ran in front of our grandparents' house, and Jeff and I, we combed probably about every inch of those railroad tracks, and being boys the way we were, we come up with the bright idea we're going to put a rock on the railroad tracks too, see if it would flatten. No, the train came through and launched it and about missed us by about 2 feet. Yeah. So, yeah, we had good times on those railroad tracks. Yeah, that rock was probably traveling a good 100 mile an hour. Yeah, we both kind of crapped our pants on that one.
There were other times we shared playing bumper pool in our grandparents' basement with all our cousins, as well as just hanging out with family. When I bought my first car, I would drive to Vicksburg, pick up my brothers, and drive around in my new wheels until the gas tank was pushing empty. When I joined the United States Air Force in 1988, seeing my family became less. I was so proud when my two little brothers wanted to serve our country too. As the years went on and our lives became busier and our times together became less frequent, we would still give each other a call, especially the week of the game, when the Michigan Wolverines played the Ohio State Buckeyes. My husband, Jason, and Jeff would text each other all week long and then congratulate each other whether win or lose. Good sportsmanship. Once my husband retired from the Air Force and we made our home in Kansas, we would come up to Michigan for visits. The older I got, the more valuable the visits became. Jason told me that when Jeff heard we were coming, he would get giddy. That made my heart so happy to know he loved seeing and spending time with us. We made his day. Now we will no longer be able to talk and share memories with Jeff, but just knowing we made a difference in his life will put our hearts at peace. We will cherish the memories we made. This is for you, brother. We love you. And as a fellow veteran, we salute you. Thank you.
family, good friends, and good memories. There's not a lot more that you can hope for the time that we spend here on Earth. Whether the days are few or many, and I don't think anybody would argue that the days here weren't long enough. It just feels like there should have been more of them. Psalm 23 is written, by a guy named David. He says this. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The first couple of verses there, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want," it goes on to talk about green pastures and quiet waters. And for a shepherd taking care of sheep, that would be vital. It would be food and water. It would be the basic things that we need in order to survive. But that part ends with, "He restores my soul." There's green pastures, there's quiet waters, and the result is that he restores my soul. Looking for rest, for times of rest and peace in this world, has become so vital. And just reading through the things that Jeff loved to do, you know, starting with fishing. I mean, I think of that and I think of relaxing. When I go fishing, I don't want to be around loud people. People, that's fine. But if it's loud people, it's because we're the ones who are loud. Anybody else needs to go somewhere else. After fishing was watching movies. And again, when I watch movies, at least, I prefer to be able to hear the movie. You know, I want to get into it. I want to kind of get lost in the story. I want to forget everything else. I want to just be able to relax. It's when you get to that last one that it becomes a little more difficult. But it was football was the last one. Because, at least for me, football it's a full contact sport even when you're by yourself. And it's loud and it's rowdy, but what you said about they would congratulate each other, win or lose, all of a sudden it has a different kind of restfulness to it. Oh, you still want your team to win, but it's about enjoying the game. It's about enjoying the moment. And the stories that you heard, sounds like Jeff enjoyed the moment. He enjoyed the opportunities to spend with people. Well, we have rest and peace. The next part of that is, he guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He leads me on the right paths. Sometimes we start out on the right paths and we get distracted by train tracks and rocks. Things that often don't get our attention, but occasionally just turn us away from what we're supposed to be doing. In this case, these paths are to, if we stay on them, will direct us in the right direction to the right location. But that leads to, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. That valley of the shadow of death can mean multiple things. It can mean the journey that we all go through at some point at what is the end of our lives. It can also, a more loose understanding of it, is the things that we are afraid to go through. I mean, in my 20 plus years as a minister, the only people that I have ever met who were looking forward to the end of their life were people who were going through extreme pain and suffering, and they just wanted it to be over. For the rest of us, it comes too early, and we dread it and we run from it and we hold it off as long as possible. And usually it's pretty safe to say that we fear it. In this case, though, it's, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. We don't have to go through it alone. Jeff doesn't have to go through it alone. There's somebody to guide him to make sure that he's on the right path. And that should be a comfort for us. The last part of that is that your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Comfort is important in the Bible at times when people are mourning. Not just for Jeff with that journey, but for those who are left behind. That we are intended to comfort each other, and sometimes God just steps in and goes, I'm just going to take care of this myself. A lot of times, though, we fill a room and we share those memories, and we're so excited to see people who we wish we were able to get together with more frequently, but for whatever reason, we aren't. The times when we are afraid, the times when that we dread, are not things that we have to go through on our own. And that is intended to be a comfort to us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. There's another part of that. But, you know, as a Michigan fan, let's face it, with Michigan football, the last few years, there have just been certain games that were dreaded. I mean, they were looked forward to. It was an opportunity to change the headlines, an opportunity to change the story that they couldn't beat just certain teams, certain situations, kind of a ridiculous story, but it's still one that just gets repeated again and again and again, and it will even when they break the story, when they change it. The thing is, as you go through those times that you're both looking forward to and dreading, it's easier to go through them with other people around you. It's harder to endure those things on your own. I'm a Chicago Cubs fan. That was a pretty rough life as a child. For a Michigan fan, it could be the same thing in those moments. But you don't have to go through those times alone. And you're here with each other now, but in the coming days, you're going to be back in your own homes, back at jobs, separated from each other. You're still only a phone call away, only an email away. And yet sometimes that just feels still so far. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. No exceptions, no exclusions. They comfort me. The last part of that, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. It talks about arrangements here that are really kind of based on security. We're overcoming enemies. You know, the reality is that enemies aren't sports teams. We sometimes treat each other that way, but that's not really enemies. The Bible talks about enemies that we face, and the big two are sin and death. Death, because it comes for everybody. Sin, because it also comes for everybody. And what the Bible says about both is that neither one gets to be ultimately victorious. It may feel like it, but that there's a time coming when the physical death on earth will end. That there is a time that has already come when sin, which the Bible talks about as disobedience, rebellion against God, when that can be dealt with because of a guy named Jesus. Here you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. The idea here is that you were chosen David writes about this shepherd that you're chosen and you were placed at a table where your enemies get to see you elevated to a place that they wish they were. Held up in a way that they wish, well, that they want to be instead of you. Jeff doesn't seem like that kind of guy that wanted to be put above others. He seemed like the kind of guy who really, for the most part, wanted to be left alone. You know, he wanted his family and his good friends around him and to enjoy life. In the times of chaos and confusion over the last couple months, seems like a lot more of us would like to be alone, away from the cares of the world, not knowing what the new headline is, not knowing what the new story is. And in this case, you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows, the storyline changes. It becomes this shepherd doing something extraordinary for one of his own. It's followed up with goodness and mercy. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Goodness and mercy are qualities that we are supposed to have that follow us because we're showing them to other people. Anyone who loves football, who chooses to be polite when winning, that is mercy. How much better would it be if we showed a little more of that? How much more do we need an example of goodness in this world? All the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life without exception, because we're supposed to be learning how to be good and show mercy. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That forever is not just the idea of a long time, it is an unending time. And the Bible talks about this place called heaven and gives some really odd descriptions. I mean, it's a place that is described as streets of gold. So you walk on the things that are really valuable here on earth. The foundations of this new city are several layers of gemstones. It's a place that is described as perfection and yet not described as perfection. That word's not actually used to describe it. That's my word. But it's a place where there's no more tears, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more suffering. I don't know if there's football. Seems like that causes a lot of pain and suffering for their fans. You know, if it is, they may be all wearing the same jersey, and I don't know that that's as enjoyable. It's a place where I could picture fishing, and you never have to tell that story. You know, the fishing story about the one that got away. Every guy seems to have one, whether they've ever been fishing or not. But where you just always have that peaceful, restful experience. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You know, the reality is that our time on earth, whether it's a lot of days or a few, is limited. And so the challenge for us is to make the most of that time. To make memories, but also to share memories of what we've done and what we wish we could do and what we hope yet to do, and to encourage and challenge each other to meet some of those goals, to get to do some of those incredible things. And I say also to share those because, yeah, putting a rock on a railroad track is just not something that's on my list of things to do. You know, now that you've told me about it, I'd really kind of like to see it. You do it again, just record it. I'll watch. You know, I'll be there with you in spirit. And that's as close as I'm getting. Yeah. Some of the things that we do that make the best memories are the things that we look back on and go, what in the world? I clearly wasn't thinking. And we don't tell those stories to our kids until they're old enough that we hope they know better. And we don't tell those stories to our parents until we hope we're old enough to not be punished. And yet, those stories make up some of the fondest memories that we have. So if you've got those stories, by all means, absolutely make the most of the time to share them. And if you don't have them, maybe you grab somebody here and you go do something that seems a little bit weird, but not frighteningly dangerous. Okay, please don't hear me wrong. Oh, this is, yeah, do you want to tell it? It, yeah, gosh, boys are just problems. So he was stubborn and quick.
I think I almost grabbed my pants.
You guys did that a lot together. Yeah.
Mom didn't like the shorts.
Yeah. Yeah. We're intended to make those kind of memories, to go through life, to take risks, to be bold, be daring, be smart. There's a fine line in there, okay? It's you cross it real easy, but to make the most of those opportunities, and at the end of it, well, at the end of it comes back the last part of Psalm 23. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. No more worries, no more distractions, no more shiny things to get us off track. Just at the end of it, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray together one more time. Father, thank you for the life that Jeff lived. And thank you for his siblings, for his family, for his friends, for the memories that they've made together, for just the very, very few that have been shared here over the last few minutes. Father, thank you for the reputation that he got, for the things that you led him through, and for the way that you kept him safe through some of those moments of boldness. And Father, as his race here on earth is run, the room is still filled with people who still have some time left. And so, God, my prayer is that whether it's a few days or a lot, that we make the most of the time we have. That goodness and mercy will follow us as we demonstrate it by the way we live. That we will look forward to dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. In Jesus' name, amen. There's going to be one more song. Those of you who are Michigan fans will recognize it. And after that, the staff here at Brown will dismiss everyone.